Hi, everyone. We're the Schleidhorns. We're sitting in our new church seats, excited for today's message to begin.
Our kids really enjoyed their church time today, especially the so-and-so show. Welcome to St. Mark's Church, and thank you for joining us.
Hey, everybody. Thank you for tuning in today. Wherever you are, we hope you'll join us as we worship. Is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but only trust in Jesus' name. Sing that with us. Hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Christ alone.
Cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within me. My anchor holds within the veil.
Therefore, this is what the Sovereign Lord says. Look, I am placing a foundation stone in Jerusalem, a firm and tested stone. It is a precious cornerstone that is safe to build on. Whoever believes need never be shaken. Isaiah 28:16.
Today and to worship our God. Won't you please take a look at this verse with me? It's from 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In His great mercy, He has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I love those words, living hope through His resurrection. How awesome it is that we serve a God that sent His Son to die for our sins. He loved us that much to give us that hope that we may be with Him one day. So I encourage you to listen to those words and to remember this verse, maybe when you're feeling down or when the craziness of this world might be getting to you, and to remember that we serve a God who gives us that living hope. Now, won't you please join us as we continue to worship and sing about that living hope.
How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke Your name into the night. Then through the darkness, Your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me His own. Beautiful Savior, I'm Yours forever, Jesus Christ. that seal the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Then in the morning, that seal the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Yeah. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Jesus Christ, my
He's so good, isn't he, church? Let's just sing about the goodness of God for all my days.
And I love you, Lord. And oh, your mercy never fails me. And all my days have been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
We sing all my life.
Oh, all my life you have been faithful. In all my life you have been so, so I love your voice. You have led me through the fires in darkest night. You are close like no other. Oh, you are. I've known you as a brother. I've known you as a friend. And I have been in the goodness God. Oh, we sing all my life. In all my life you have been faithful. Yes, you have. In all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness.
Running after me. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. And my life may down and surround.
yes, you have. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, and I will sing of the goodness of God. I'm gonna sing, 'cause you're good. The line that says, with every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. And that really stood out to me as I was singing this, because I just heard the Lord ask, do you really sing with every breath that you're able? And I was just really encouraged and reminded of His goodness in all seasons, in all circumstances, and that no matter what we face, we can sing that He is good. And that is our testimony as believers. That is a truth that we can cling to no matter what. So wherever you're at, I just encourage you to sing that again. We're going to sing that chorus, all my life you have been faithful and so good, that with every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. And I pray that you really just meditate on these lyrics as we sing them together. Many locations, but one church this morning. Sing all my life.
All my life you have been faithful. Sing it from your heart to head. All my life you have been so, so good. Yes, you have. And with every breath that I am able,
we sing it out.
I will sing of the goodness. Is running after me. You've been faithful. And all my life has been faithful. All my life has been so, so good. You see, half with every breath that I am able. I will sing of the goodness of God.
Sing, we will sing.
We will sing of the goodness of God.
He's so good, church. Cling to that today.
Good morning, SMC. This is Margaret Luton, your Missions and Outreach Director. If you're new to SMC, we want to thank you for being here. Please text NEW to 64600. We'd love to reach out to you, and thank you for joining us. If you're looking for opportunities to serve this summer, our Missions and Outreach Department, along with Positive Attitude Youth Center, is working together with Beaumont Avenue Apartments to put on a small summer camp on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 9 to 12. If you'd like to join in and help, you can go to exploresmc.org/events to sign up. If you've been at SMC long, you know that every year we give every child at East Lawn Elementary School a backpack full of all the items that they'll need to get started in their year. If you'd like to sponsor a child, you can go to exploresmc.org/give. And we want to thank you for joining us today.
Hi, everybody, and midsummer greetings. Let me just pause a second and remind you that our annual summer baptism service is just 7 weeks from today, August 30th. So, hey, let us know if we can help you, if you're trying to figure that out, if you're in the process of trying to decide, and we'll see if we can help you take the next step. You might also want to know that next Sunday, my brother Eric is, he's going to be in the house preaching. So you know you're going to want to watch that because who knows? He doesn't know. We don't know. It'll be surprises for everybody. Hey, look, when I was in college, during my summer and Christmas breaks, I worked for our city's electrical department. It was a construction crew. We called it, my particular job was on the line crew. We were building the electrical grid for our modest small town, Lexington, North Carolina. Now, this was way before the day when bucket trucks were popular, so linemen had to climb the wooden poles to do their work. I was the guy on the ground, better known as, they called us, that we were grunts. Can't figure that one out. But I spent my days pulling on a hand line to make sure that the lineman up the pole had the equipment and the tools necessary to complete the job. Now, you would be amazed at how many wasps and hornets like to build their nest under on the underside of a transformer. So guess what old college boy got to do? We had some heavy-duty wasp and hornet killer. So since I was the novice in the group and the youngest member of the construction crew, also known as I could run faster, that was my job. Do you know the saying, madder than a hornet? Well, I was the guy that came up with that because here's what would happen. If you hit the hornet, he's out. But if you slightly miss, you got a mad hornet on your hands. So I spent some time running for my life if I was a little bit off target. You might be surprised at how much the Bible has to say about this unpredictable, explosive emotion called anger. And even Jesus had plenty to say about the repercussions of mismanaging this natural but sometimes volatile passion. One of my favorite Bible teachers, Steve Brown, he says that anger is a felony. Now, I know some of you are going to push back against that idea, so we're going to go there today. Welcome to week 6. Now, look, this is week 18 of this crazy pandemic. 18 straight weeks when we've been doing this digital church. We appreciate your support. Week 6 of the summer preaching series. This summer, what we've been trying to do in a series that we call Jesus Changes Everything, we're trying to close the gap between what Jesus said and then our motivation and compliance to do what he said. So thanks for joining us today from wherever you're watching. Take a look at this memorable scene from one of the classic movies of all times, Forrest Gump.
Every day we'd take a walk and I'd jabber on like a monkey in a tree. And she'd listen about ping-ponging and shrimping and Mama making a trip up to heaven. I did all the talking. Jenny most of the times was real quiet. Sometimes I guess there just aren't enough rocks.
It's the hardest thing to give away and the last thing on your mind today. It always goes to those who don't deserve. the opposite of how you feel. When the pain they cause is just too real, takes everything you have to say the word forgiveness. Forgiveness flies in the face of all your pride and moves away the mad inside. It's always anger's own worst enemy. Even when the jury and the judge say you got a right to hold a grudge, it's the whisper in your ear saying set it free. Forgiveness. Forgiveness. Show me how to love the unlovable. Show me how to reach the unreachable. Help me now to do forgiveness. Forgiveness. Help me now to do the impossible. Forgiveness. It'll clear the bitterness away. It can even set a prisoner free. No end to what its power can do. Oh, so let it go and be amazed by what you see through eyes of grace. The prisoner that it really frees is you. Forgiveness. Forgiveness. Show me how to love unlovable. Show me how to reach the unreachable. Help me now to do the impossible. Forgiveness. I want to finally set it free. Show me how to see what your mercy sees. What you gave to me, forgiveness. Oh, forgiveness. Forgiveness.
Oh, forgiveness.
Forgiveness. Forgiveness.
Let me take you to probably the greatest sermon ever preached. This is in Matthew 5. Jesus said, "You have heard that it was said to your ancestors, never murder. Whoever murders will answer for it in court. But I can guarantee that whoever is angry with another believer will answer for it in court. Whoever calls another believer an insulting name will answer for it in the highest court. Whoever calls another believer a fool will answer for it in hell." My goodness. Let's think about that. There are two Greek words in the original language in the New Testament that we translate into English, and it's represented by one word, anger. One of those words is thermos. Now, that's where we get the English word thermos, as in a thermos bottle, which is designed to keep a beverage of choice either cold or hot. Although I've always wondered, how does the thermos know which one? But that's for somebody else. That's above my pay grade. The point is, thermos, like thermos, is temporary. I mean, you put a hot liquid in a thermos and it's not going to keep it hot forever and ever. It's temporary. It's more like a small brush fire that burns quickly and then it just kind of dies out. These would be things that You know, the things that irritate us, that get under our skin, like slow Wi-Fi or stuck in traffic. It's the person who takes up three parking spaces, junk mail, mountains of online shopping catalogs, computer freeze-ups, your flight gets delayed for the third time, annoying potholes, sleeping next to somebody who snores, forgetting an important password, the referee makes a bad call, your favorite restaurant is still closed because of COVID, the line at Starbucks is ridiculously long, and when are the gyms going to get open again? Nobody even listens to me anymore, your employees, your spouse, your kids, and even the family dog. Now, if you allow these everyday distractions to disrupt your life for, let's say, more than a few minutes, you'd better call a therapist, or better yet, I have a suggestion. I've got a couple of books here that might be useful to you. This one is called Don't Sweat the Small Stuff, and it's simple ways to keep the little things from taking over your life. Now, suppose you don't like to read. Well, you can sit in your favorite chair and chew on the edges of this book. There's even one designed for teenagers. It's called Don't Sweat the Small Stuff, Simple Ways to Keep Your Cool in Stressful Times. It's for teenagers, it says. So now look, they can read it, or if they don't like to read, you can use the book. You can put them in their bedroom and then wedge their bedroom door shut, and you can lock them in there for a while. Thermos, things that cause us angst and irritation. But the other Greek word that we translate as anger is the word orgizo. And this is a kind of frustration that just hangs around way too long. It's outrage, indignation. It's like anger on steroids. It's the spouse who breaks a marriage vow, the person who cuts a financial corner and swindles you out of a business deal, costing you tens of thousands of dollars. Somebody tells a lie that tarnishes your character, wrecks your reputation. You're tempted to get even, to go to social media, to start telling the whole world just how corrupt and despicable these people are. In this passage from Matthew 5, guess which of the two words Jesus uses? Oh yeah, orgizo. And that's the way Jesus, what he's teaching here in this sermon is that if you fail to put on the brakes, and if you don't deal with your pain, the hurt, the angst, the anger that can turn a destructive pattern of behavior and a life-altering decision, if you can't begin to figure that out, it can fragment your life and you can be slip-sliding from frustration to bitterness to resentment, and it will even grow into hatred. When somebody hurts you, maybe steals months or even years from your childhood, wrecks a career dream, breaks a promise made, it's possible for us to rehearse these things in our minds and hearts, and we put them on replay, and they just play over and over, and the pain can sometimes last for years, or in some cases, even decades. But Jesus never wanted that to happen. He didn't want to see our crushed hearts and our shattered dreams to drive us toward the weeds of hostility, cynicism, and animosity. Maybe you saw this picture. Take a look at this. This is an angry bride-to-be who found out that her fiancé was cheating. So she just burned the wedding dress. Or, hey, look, how about this angry woman? Now, was this a woman determined to get even? Look at this billboard. It says, "Hi, Stephen. Do I have your attention now? I know all about her, you dirty, sneaky, immoral, unfaithful, poorly endowed slime ball. Everything's caught on tape. P.S. I paid for this billboard from our joint bank account." That's an angry woman. Anger is kind of like the check engine light on the dashboard of your car. It's an alarm that tells you something is not working, at least not the way it's supposed to. You know what occurred to me this week as I was working my way through this sermon? I wondered if God ever, do you think God ever asked us to do anything more difficult than to forgive somebody? Or maybe a bunch of somebodies, people who've hurt us. Forgiveness is hard work. After all, forgiveness cost God everything, including the life of his son. I sometimes think about forgiveness as, compare it to emptying a trash can. There's no such thing as emptying out the trash one last time. You don't empty the trash and say, well, I'll never have to do that again. If you're like us, you roll that large container to the street every week. But then, in a few days, it's full again, no matter what. Well, extending forgiveness is kind of like that. It's a day-after-day grind, and we just have to keep emptying the trash that can accumulate in here. Now, think about it. If this room right now were full of people, and if I asked for a show of hands and I said, who in here has ever been disappointed, hurt, betrayed by another person? Every hand would go up, including mine. Many of the conversations that I have with people every week, there are those who have somehow been wounded or mistreated or victimized. And as painful as it is to say or to hear, and even more difficult to put into practice, there's only one way to fix the hurt. Heart surgery. That surgery is called forgiveness. One day Peter said to Jesus, teacher, someone hurt me. We might say, done me wrong. So how many times should I forgive this habitual offender? Seven times? Now the standard religious minimum requirement in those days was three times. So Peter must have felt like, man, I'm going over the top. I'm more than doubling that. So, hey, Jesus, will seven times do it? If I take out the trash seven times, is that going to be enough? I wonder if Peter expected Jesus to say, Peter, man, you are amazing. You are offering more than two times what our religious law demands. But instead, Jesus said, I'll tell you this, Peter, not just seven times, but 70 times seven. Now look, I can do the math. You can too. So let me pause to remind you what forgiveness is not, because there's a lot of confusion about that. Forgiveness is not just excusing somebody and letting them off the hook. Now we excuse small children when they misbehave in the grocery store, or an expectant father who's breaking the speed limit, driving his pregnant wife to the delivery room. We will excuse the 10-year-old boys for making inappropriate body sounds. When an activity or a decision is excusable, it doesn't need forgiveness. So forgiveness is a lot more than saying, okay, no problem, you're excused. Forgiveness is also not forgetting. There's a lot of confusion about that. Sometimes, you know, I forget where I placed a book or laid my car keys down. That's a failure of short-term memory. It's a lot different than forgetting something serious that someone has done to hurt me. Yeah, but Bob, didn't the Old Testament prophet Jeremiah say God will remember our sins no more? He did say that. But that doesn't mean that God has amnesia. It means that God thinks about us the way he would, as if he had completely forgotten. Write this down. This is a big deal. Forgiveness is a decision to forgive what we still remember. I hope that makes sense. Now, there's no question that reconciliation is the best way for our relational pain to be rehabilitated. But there are times when something happens in a relationship that is so life-shattering that trust just implodes. But we can still exist together on planet Earth if we choose forgiveness. Forgiveness. Forgiveness is a decision that we make. Let's talk about that. Take a look at this image. This is the kindness-saturated face of Pope John Paul II. He led the Catholic Church during my early years of ministry right here at SMC. John Paul was chosen in the fall of 1978 to lead the Catholic Church. And then a few years later, May 13th, 1981, an attempt was made on the Pope's life when he was shot in an assassination attempt. 2 years later, the Pope met with the man who attempted to take his life in order to be able to extend forgiveness. Look at this picture. This picture of forgiveness that made the cover of Time magazine. And pay close attention to the question on the cover of this secular publication. The question is, why forgive? I'm going to tell you something, everybody. The whole world wants to know that. Why forgive? They want to know that because forgiveness doesn't compute in a broken world that prioritizes get even more than forgive. Later, John Paul would write, forgiveness is above all a personal choice, a decision of the heart to go against the natural instinct to pay back evil with evil. We were all awakened on October the 6th, 2006, to a sickening tragedy that occurred in this one-room Amish schoolhouse, the West Nickel Mine School. It's not too far from Lancaster, Pennsylvania. 11 children were shot execution style, and 5 little girls died. The world was also inexplicably shocked just a couple of days later when, in the middle of their nightmare of grief, the Amish community did not point fingers. They didn't hold a press conference surrounded by a team of lawyers. Instead, they reached out with grace and compassion toward the killer's family. The afternoon of the shooting, Amish neighbors visited the widow to comfort her in her family's heart-crushing grief and pain in this incomprehensible expression of mercy and grace. On the day of the man's funeral, more than 30 Amish members of the Amish community attended the service in a demonstration of forgiveness. Now, you try to make sense of that, and you'll go crazy. It's hard to understand the power of grace and forgiveness over get even. Barely 5 years ago, June 17th, 2015, a 22-year-old self-proclaimed white supremacist walked into a small Bible study gathering at the Emmanuel AME Church in Charleston, South Carolina, murdered 9 African Americans, including the church's pastor. At the trial, this reprehensible 22-year-old said with cold-hearted hatred, "I do not regret what I did, and I'm not sorry." But even with that level of bitter hatred and hostility, family members of the victims addressed the killer and they said, "We forgive you and we pray for your soul." That phenomenon of grace and forgiveness seems inconceivable in a broken world where we live, but God is clear in His Word that forgiveness is a choice, it's a decision that we make. Well, just as we've done in these past 6 weeks of the series, today we're going to shine a bright light on another one of God's values that He hardwired into His set of priorities, and that is the willingness to reconcile and rebuild broken relationships. Well, wait a minute, Bob. I thought we covered that last week in painful detail when we talked about the two chairs. And we did. But if I failed to mention that Jesus spent more than one of His sermons on this subject of forgiveness, well, I figure we should too. So here's the understatement of the year. Some of the people in your life will invariably say and do something that's really stupid. Unless you live on a deserted island, it's just a matter of time before somebody says or does something that sabotages this relationship, or at least puts it on thin ice. The more I've studied this passage in Matthew 5, and the more I've worked alongside of messed up people like myself, I'm pretty sure that most of us just kind of skim over these words of Jesus. But unless we close the gap between what Jesus said and what we do with what He said, chances are we might never experience His transformational power. So this value of forgiveness, It has the power to. It can change your family, transform your marriage. It will change how you relate to your coworkers and the members of your small group. It can change the place where you work or play, hang out, or work out. But the principles and priorities that we're going to look at today might be almost completely ignored by most of the people in this world, and quite frankly, by much of the Jesus community, and that's too bad. Jesus is clear that anger is so dangerous that he describes it as heart murder, which is a felony. Now, right now, some of you are thinking, come on, Bob, no way, man. I get angry. Sometimes I get angry a lot, but it's more like a misdemeanor. It's kind of like a speed bump. It can't possibly be that serious. Matthew 5. Jesus said, "You have heard that it was said to our people long ago, you must not murder anyone. Anyone who murders another will be judged. But I tell you, if you are angry with a brother or sister, you will be judged. If you say bad things to a brother or sister, you will be judged by the council. And if you call someone a fool, you will be in danger of the fire of hell." Now, Jesus is speaking in this moment, preaching to an almost 100% Jewish audience. Maybe there could have been a few exceptions with maybe a handful of people in the crowd who have no faith at all, but mostly people who were born and bred in the Jewish faith. And what does he say? You heard it a long time ago. You've heard this your entire life. Don't kill other people. And where had they heard that? Ten Commandments, Moses, Mount Sinai. We're talking top 10, number 6. And that makes sense. If you kill somebody, you'll be subjected to judgment. You'll have to stand before a judge and a dozen people on a panel, and they will hear the evidence and they will judge you guilty or not. There's almost universal agreement in every country, in every culture around the world, one side of this planet to the other, murder, guilty. So did Jesus go over the top? Is he adding a little something to the original Ten Commandments? Is he wanting to extend this in some way? No, he's teaching us just how deep some of these commandments can go. One commentator calls anger a form of heart murder. For example, 14-year-old teenager is so angry with her parents when they refuse to let her go to a party and a sleepover. And they say no because she's continually ignored the importance of keeping her homework up to speed and her room in order. Can you say drama? There is drama worthy of a Hollywood movie. She goes spewing out of the family room, and just before slamming a couple of doors, she screams, "I hate you and I wish I had different parents." What she's saying is, "I wish you weren't in my life. I wish you were gone." Heart murder. A married couple gets in a sparring match over some financial pressures. One person is blaming the other for reckless spending and screams and says, "Why do you continue to run up a mountain of credit card charges? We're never going to get control of this thing. What are you thinking? In fact, I wish I had married somebody else with self-control." And it's getting dangerously close to saying, "I wish you were out of my life. I can't trust you." That's another way of saying, "You don't even exist to me anymore." Heart murder. And while I'm on this one, can we talk about the church? I'm telling you, churches are famous, or maybe infamous, for wounding people, hurting people. And I'm not talking specifically about SMC, but I am talking about SMC. Because there is no telling how many people have been hurt, rejected, pushed aside, labeled, discarded over the years in this church. Surely there have been times when I've been somehow a part of that pain and rejection. There have also been times when I've been the recipient of anger and bitterness. I get that, so do you. Jesus warned us about people who will get up alongside of us. He says there will be people who will come up alongside of you in sheep's clothing, but underneath the mask, they are ferocious and on a mission of destruction. I'll tell you, some of the meanest, most selfish and narcissistic people I have ever known claim to be the followers of Jesus. And sometimes the only way to manage the pain that some people leave in the wake of their life is just to quietly pick up the trash and go empty what they have left behind. A generation later, look at what Paul writes to the believers in Rome. He says, never pay back evil with more evil. Do things in such a way that everyone can see that you are honorable. And here's the key. As far as it depends on you, me, do all you can to live in peace with everyone. We've been learning a bunch of lessons in these past 4.5 months about the value of quarantining and creating some safe distance. But here's what I'll tell you about anger, and you know this. It's lousy. It does a lousy job when it comes to quarantine. I've lost count the number of people who have said, Bob, after what's happened to me, I have a right to be angry. And my first reaction is, yeah, you do, but your anger might be reasonable, but anger doesn't typically stay in its place. And if you allow the most likely foundations of anger to linger there for a while, I'm talking about hurt, frustration, fear, or disappointment, which are almost always the causes of anger. If you allow those to stay down in here somewhere, I'm telling you, you allow those emotions to find a hiding place in your heart. They will eventually start to leak out and spread, or else one day, all of those emotions will coagulate in your heart and create an all-out insurrection. The emotions that feed our anger are highly contagious and infectious. So if we allow anger to settle somewhere inside of us, it's very hard to somehow dislodge it. It's better to take the trash out, or even better still, just put up a no trespassing sign. Hey, anger, you're not welcome here. This was a high priority item for Jesus. This is how I want you to conduct yourself, he said. If you enter your place of worship and you are about to make an offering and you suddenly remember a grudge that a friend has against you, abandon your offering. Leave immediately, go to this friend and make things right. Then, and only then, come back and work things out with God. Make peace quickly with your opponent. So why the sense of urgency? Because Jesus knows, and so do we, that unresolved conflict almost always escalates. Let me illustrate that. This time of year, it's typical to start hearing about out-of-control forest fires, especially in some of our western states. And the fact is that every single one of those fires started with a spark. Fires are a whole lot easier to put out before they become a raging, destructive forest fire with the capacity, you've seen this on the news, to destroy everything in their path. So what does that mean in real life? Hey, look, call a counselor before your marriage is hanging by a thread, or before one or both of you have allowed your broken, frustrated hearts to even drift somewhere else. Put the fire out quickly. Have a family intervention if there's somebody with some addictive behavior, if it's raging out of control, like alcohol, drugs, pornography, eating disorder, shopping, gambling, social media, smartphones, video games, even gossip. Interventions almost always have a better chance of success in the early days of the addiction than they do if we let it linger. Schedule some time with a financial advisor as soon as you notice that consumer debt is beginning to grow exponentially, because eventually it will become insurmountable. Whatever might be a small fire right now, just say, we will not allow this destructive fire to rage into a forest fire and wreck our future. Pick up the phone, make the hard call, write the letter, reach out a hand, settle matters quickly, ask for forgiveness, call for a peace summit. A small fire left unattended never stays that way. Sometimes we just need to empty the trash before it overflows. Did you ever hear the true story about Dave? This guy lives in Colorado, and he works, he has a part-time job as an umpire in a summer recreational softball league. A couple of winters ago, he was pulled over by an officer who gave him a ticket for driving too fast for the snow-covered road conditions. Well, Dave tried to reason with the officer and talk his way out of the ticket. Officer wouldn't budge, just told Dave, he said, "Hey, look, you can go to court and appeal the ticket." Now, no kidding, watch this. The following summer, first game of the season, Dave is behind home plate calling balls and strikes. The first batter up was that police officer who gave him the ticket in February. Well, the officer and Dave look at each other. They recognize one another. And as the officer stepped into the batter's box, he said, "So, how did things work out with your ticket?" Dave looked at the officer and said, let me just put it to you this way. You'd better swing at everything." Kind of one of those get even moments. That's some sweet revenge. But many times, the stakes are a whole lot higher than a speeding ticket. As you know, human history has been conveniently divided into ages. For example, in the 18th century, there was the Industrial Age. The 19th century, when this church was born, it was called the Machine Age. The first half of the 20th century was the Age of Innocence. But that era quickly came to a screeching halt with the Age of Revolution in the 1960s. In the 50s and 60s, it was the Space Age. The 70s and 80s brought on the computer, the Digital Age. In the 90s, we developed information overload. So we just called it the Information Age. In the late 90s, it was the Technology Age. Facebook was born in 2004, introducing us to the age of social media, followed by the smartphone age in 2007. Now we all have a high-tech computer in our pockets and purse. And a little over a decade ago, everybody wanted to know, is there an app for that? Do you know what the past 2 or 3 years are being labeled? The age of rage. We're just mad. We're mad about everything. We're mad about politics and political systems. We're angry about economic disparity. We're angry about injustice and controversial statues and questionable flags. And we're ticked off about Me Too and Black Lives Matter, and we got this gender and racial divide. We're angry about guns and mass shootings and somebody telling us that we have to wear a mask. A man that I respect a lot said to me this week, "Bob, I have a right to be angry." And I said, "You're right. No question. You have a right to be ticked. And so do I. But is that the way you really want to live?" So I said, "Maybe you should consider being passionate instead of angry." Do you know the difference? Anger prepares us to fight and devalue and tear down and destroy. Passion preps us to build and create and improve and fix and celebrate. Anger leads to exhaustion, frustration, depression. Passion will lead to purpose and conviction. It was leadership expert John Maxwell. He likes to say, "Everybody carries a bucket of gas and a bucket of water, and when a fire breaks out, we all have a choice to make." Here's the way I like to say it. You can't rock the boat and row the boat at the same time. And I was thinking just this week, in this age of rage, I think about it like this. You've heard me say this. You can be a bridge, or you can tear one down. That's why Jesus never prioritized peacekeeping. Have you ever noticed that? Peacekeeping basically means that we avoid the conflict. We sidestep the bridges.
But he did call us to be peacemakers, to build a bridge. Later, his half-brother James would give us the formula for peacemaking bridge building. James writes, "My dear brothers and sisters, you should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry. If you are angry, you cannot do any of the good things that God wants done," James writes. Let me tell you something. You've heard me say this, certainly in these past 4 or 5 weeks as we've tried to figure out this whole racial divide. I've been trying really hard to follow this godly advice. Sit to listen before I stand to speak. But in my lifetime, I've never heard so many people screaming about the entitlement. We are entitled to our First Amendment rights of free speech. And then social media outlets are giving people a broad platform to say whatever, whenever, wherever, and however. It's another good, I thought this, there's another reason why I don't do social media. So I hope I'm not the only one who wonders what might happen if we just stopped screaming about our rights and started leveraging the plans and the priorities of God. So the next time you take to social media, just be reminded as a follower of Jesus that we live by a higher standard than a government-mandated Bill of Rights. Jesus put some serious boundaries and margins around freedom of speech, and for good reason. Of course, Jesus spoke the truth. He was a great truth teller. At SMC, we are absolutely 100% over the top devoted to announce the truth about God in all that we do. But so many times, listen everybody, it's how we choose to deliver the truth that matters. What was the formula that James wrote about? He said, be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to get angry. It's always a good idea to pause, take a deep breath, and give God at least a few minutes to help you determine whether or not you should say something. And then how best to say it. And should I say it right now? Here's a word of truth. You ought to post this on the fridge or maybe even on your computer keyboard. Don't have anything to do with stupid arguments. Stay away from disagreements and quarrels about meaningless matters. Such arguments are useless and senseless. So here's a simple series of questions. Always ask yourself, is it true? Is it helpful? Is it necessary? And is it kind? Henry Cloud, in his book on boundaries, tells one of my favorite stories about a strong, successful family business. The father was the CEO. His son was the chief operating officer. One day, his dad walked up on him, overheard the son reprimanding one of the employees. The young man was making some abrasive and unnecessary words or saying it in a way that was just bad. Dad calls his son into his office and said, "Hey, son, I am both your boss and your dad. And as your boss, I'm firing you because we don't manage people the way you just talked to that man." Son didn't say a word. And then his father said, "And as your dad, I want you to know that I just heard you lost your job today. And I'm sorry about that. Maybe we can work something out." My friends, there are days when God has to correct us and serve up some appropriate discipline. We say the wrong words, or we do the wrong thing. We send the wrong text or email. Maybe we scream at the wrong kid. Could be we neglect the wrong friend. And God puts on his boss hat to correct us. But then he quickly puts on his father hat and forgives us more completely than we could ever deserve. A man that I hardly know recently sent me an email, gave me permission to read it. He said, "Bob, I went in for my annual checkup. There were some things a little bit out of whack with my lab work. Some follow-up tests determined a stage 4 cancer diagnosis. I'll be fortunate if I can win this war for much beyond a couple of years. It's going to be a tough battle." And then he wrote, "I'm determined to mend some fences that I should have paid attention to a long time ago. So I'm reaching out to everybody I know to apologize for anything I've said or done that somehow interrupted our friendship. I so regret that it took a scary diagnosis for me to cross the bridge to fix what's broken." He said, "I'm in some serious and rigorous treatment right now, so my days are unpredictable. But I would welcome a conversation if that could be helpful." Sometimes a difficult or tragic season serves as a wake-up call. And that's when we realize that could be we've been careless or narrow-minded or biased, maybe intolerant. But then there's an outstretched hand and an open heart hoping to restore what was broken. You know, sometimes there just aren't enough rocks. Maybe we ought to just put the rocks down. Sometimes maybe it's best just to leave the hornets alone. Take out the trash one more time. Give God a chance to rebuild a bridge, to restore a marriage, reconnect a friendship, and forgive what was broken. Paul says in Romans 12, "As far as it depends on you, do all you can to live in peace with everybody." I love you, SMC. Let's pray. If it helps you to put your hands out and open, let's do that. Jesus, for the second, third, fourth, fifth chances, we lost count a long time ago. We humble ourselves. Spirit of God, we lean into you as the one who can temper our hearts and carve off some of the rough places. Where there is brokenness, or if there are hearts a part of this service that are shattered into 100 pieces, would you begin to lovingly and appropriately begin to amend that broken spirit? And God, by your mercy and grace, would you extend to us the reality of what that cross delivered, set free, and give us the courage to extend freedom to somebody this week where something is broken, we pray. In the name of the peacemaker, Jesus. Amen. Come on and let the light in. Your love changes everything. And in the darkest hour.
I will fear no evil, 'cause you'll never let me go. You'll never let me go. So come on into the waters. Come let the broken say. Come on, you sons and daughters. His love changes everything. So come when the